So good morning all. Today we are going to start a new unit, which is the gear. So the new unit is gear. Now, what is the function of gear? So gears are used. Gears are used to transfer the power or motion from one shaft to another. With a condition that in such a way that omega 1, if omega 1 is the speed of the shaft 1 and omega 2 is the speed of the shaft 2, the ratio of their speeds should always be the constant. Then only we can call that system which is doing this work as a gear. So this is the important condition which has to be fulfilled by the system which is transferring the power from one shaft to another shaft. In order to understand this, let us consider two friction disks. For example, I have one friction disk and the other friction disk. And they are making some contact. Here. That it is the center of this disk and this is the center of this disk. Suppose this is rotating in this direction, and because of the friction on its surface and on the surface of this one, this will rotate in this direction. Okay, let us suppose that they are rotating with some angular speed omega 1 and omega 2, okay, and the radius of this disk is R1 and this disk is R2. So at the point of contact of these two disks, we will have a velocity component. For example, this point is Q, so we will have VQ. And the value of this VQ will be equal to, with respect to the disk number 2, it can be given as R2 into omega 2, and for the first disk it can be defined as R1 omega 1. And if there is no slipping between the disks, what does it mean? It means that they are under pure rolling condition. Then in that case, I can write it as that R1 omega 1 is equal to R2 omega 2. So I can write it to be as omega 1 by omega 2 equal to R2 by R1. This R2 by R1 represents the ratio of the radius, which will not change with time. So we can conclude that omega 1 by omega 2 is equal to a constant. So this was the prime condition which we considered, that for a system to be called as gear, the ratio of the angular speed should be equal to constant, and for the considered friction disk, and for the considered friction disk, the ratio of omega 1 to omega 2, it can be given as R2 by R1. These are friction disk. Okay. Now, if slip happens, if between disk number 1 and disk number 2 some slip happens, then the point of contact at Q will have different velocities. They will have different velocities with respect to disk 1 and 2. So this Q will have different velocity with respect to 1 and 2. So we can write that in that case R1 omega 1 is not equal to R2 omega 2. I hope this is clear. So from here I can write it to be as omega 1 by omega 2 is not equal to R2 by R1, and since this factor is constant, so I can write that omega 1 by omega 2 is not equal to a constant. So they will not be called as the gears. So those drives where chances of slip are there are called as negative drives. So all those drives, where the chances of slip are there are called as negative drives. What would be the possible example of it? Yes, the belt and pulley system. So in that case we have the chances of some slip. Next, so if there are no slip and the drives where slipping is highly impossible, are called as positive drives. For example, gears. as we have considered that for the gears, the ratio of omega 1 to omega 2 should be a constant, and it will be a constant only when there is no slip. So the application of gears where the gear are used are all comes under the category of the positive drives. For example, let me take a very simple example where gears are used is the watch, the mechanical watch, where the slipping between the components of the watch is not permitted. If that will happen, then the watch will represent different times with as the time passes. So this is the one of the examples where gears are used. Next we have the classification of gears. Classification of gears. Generally we have several types or ways to classify it. The first one is according to axis of shafts connected. This is the one way of classifying the gears. The another way is according to gearing. Another way according to teeth. Let us take or discuss these one by one. The first one is according to axis of the shafts. Now, in the initial discussion, we considered that these friction discs are made in such a way that there will not be any slipping. So how to ensure that there will not be any slipping? So for that we need to increase the roughness on the surface of these disc. And how to increase that roughness? The one way is to increase that roughness. For example, this is the first one and this is the second gear, second disc. How can we increase the roughness? Roughness is what? It represents the surface asperities. Okay, now the best way to increase the roughness is to cut some projections on it. If we cut some projection on both these discs with the help of some method, if we could cut some roughness on the periphery of these friction disc, that will result in a perfect match and will transfer the motion from one shaft to another shaft without any slipping. So these teeth are responsible to provide a slip free motion. Now to discuss the types, these are called as gears. These were the friction discs. From friction discs we generated the gears. Now we have the different classification. The first classification is according to axis of shafts connected. So this is the one example of those gears. That we have a shaft. We have a shaft. This is the one shaft. Okay, and this is the another shaft. And the power is being transferred from one shaft to another shaft. So, if I draw a diagram to represent it, for example, let this is the one shaft and this is the another shaft. These shafts are supported on some bearings. This represents the bearing. Okay, this represents the bearing. Now, on its surface, we have a element which is known as gear, and this will be the second gear. Okay, so how we generated these gears? First, we need to make a generating line. So this will be the generating line. Then we will rotate this generating line about the shaft axis or about the shaft. So if we rotate this line about this axis, what we will get? We will get a shape like this. And similarly for the shaft number 2, this is 1, this is 2. So if we look it from this side, if this is Ri, if we look it from here, you will realize that let me give it A and B, you will see two shafts A and two shaft, shaft number 1 and shaft number 2 are in contact with the help of these gears, the disc, these friction disc. Now, to make it a slipless or slip free phenomena, we need to create some teeth on the surface of A and B. So we need to create teeth on its periphery. On its periphery, to what is the function? To avoid the slip. And if teeths are, if teeths, if teeths are parallel to each other, these are called spur gears, or parallel to each other and shaft as well. So these are called as spur gears. Okay, so if you can imagine that this is the shaft axis, and to parallel of it we have cut some teeth on the periphery of the those friction disc, and these teeth are parallel to each other with respect to shaft and also to the shaft. So these type of teeth are known as the spur gears. What would be the possible problem in it? These are the spur gears. What would be the possible problem in these type of gears? That In these gears, there is sudden engagement. Disengagement of teeth, so that will produce sudden impact. Stresses and also due to it the operation becomes a bit noisy. There will be great noise as compared to other gears. Let me explain it. For example, this is the teeth of one shaft and this is the teeth of another shaft. Another gear. So when this teeth while rotating will strike on this teeth, when this teeth A while rotating strikes on the teeth B, so it will make a sudden contact throughout the length of the teeth, so that will create great amount of impact stresses which would limit the life of the teeth. So what we can do to avoid this, we can make the teeth. So if the teeth are made inclined to axis, of the shaft, then this problem of sudden engagement and disengagement can be avoided. So for example, this is the shaft and this is the gear on it. If we make teeth at an angle to the shaft, and for the other gear which is on the another shaft, these teeth will be in opposite direction. They are in this direction, so the teeth on the other shaft will be on this direction. So when the teeth of, for example, gear A meshes with B, so they will have a gradual contact from the one end of the teeth to the other end of the teeth, and during the disengagement also the teeth will leave first from the one end, then will leave to the other end. So by this way we can reduce the impact stresses. What we need to keep in mind, that the two mating gears in this case must have same helix angle. What is helix angle now? Helix angle. So this angle which is made by the teeth with the axis of the shaft is represented as the helix angle. It represents as the helix angle. So for one shaft it should be in this direction, and for the other shaft it should be in this direction for the perfect mating of the teeth. So these type of teeth or gears are known as helical gears. So this is the representation of a helical gear. Now here, if this is the shaft axis, so these are making some angle, the teeth are making some angle with the shaft axis, which is the helix angle. Now here, in these type of gears, these types of helical gears, let me draw it further. If this is the gear which is in contact with another gear, let me make it, these are the teeth, this is only another gear, and this is the shaft. So here, during the meshing, the force which is responsible, or the force which is generated in this case, is generally normal to the teeth. So this will be the force that it is represented by F. Now this force will have two component. One will be in this direction, which is represented as Ft, for example. This one is Ft, and another one is in this direction, which is the axial force. Okay, which is the axial force. Okay, now this component of force Ft represents, or with the help of the shape of these teeth like helical, so this Ft is responsible to transfer the required power, required torque. And this component Fx, axial thrust, will try to separate the gears. So this Fxial should be eliminated, and for that we can make a new type of teeth on the gear, which is the, that this is the teeth and this is the central axis. On the one side we can make teeth by taking the helix angle like this, and on the other side we can make teeth by taking the helix angle of the sides. So here what we will get, we will get an Ft and some axial thrust Fa to this side, and for the other side we will get F axial and F thrust. This F torque from both sides will add up to transfer the torque, and this F axial will get cancelled out, will get eliminated. So the axial thrust is eliminated. And these type of gear profile is known as herring bone gears. So this is the third type of the first category. If I represent it with the help of a diagram, we can show it that this is the helical gear. This is the helical gear. That was the helical gear. Now I am drawing the herringbone. This is the one gear. This is the another gear. This is the center. And these are the teeth. These are the teeth. Now, if the teeth are cut in such a fashion that there is no gap between the two teeth, so on the below gear, teeth will be in opposite direction, as I had already discussed to complete the meshing. Now, this is one type, and if we can also eliminate the axial thrust by making these type of gears by this method also. So here, if we make one teeth here and then some gap between the teeth, some constant gap, so these type of gears will also eliminate the axial thrust, but these will not be known as herringbone. These will be double helical gears, and these are herringbone gears. Okay, so we will discuss the another two classifications in the next lecture. So thank you very much for the listening.